Welcome, my name is Sees van Beers, and I'm a professor of innovation management at Delft University of Technology. Today, I will present a lecture on determinants of innovation. As we know from the previous lecture what innovations are, now we want to examine what determines successful technological innovation. In order to do so, we first have to say something about who are the actors that innovate and what are their motivations. Second, I will explain how we can scale up innovations. And third, I will focus on determinants or incentives that influence the innovation performance of private, profit-oriented firms. So, who are the actors that innovate? As innovation is a human activity, the straight answer should be the individual inventor. The individual inventor is a creative person who is stimulated by intrinsic motivation. That means that his or her driver to innovate is personal interest in specific technological problems. Combined with their personal ability of creativity, they solve these technological problems with new answers. One example of such an individual inventor is Thomas Edison, who invented the light bulb. Another example is Rudolf Diesel, who invented the diesel engine. In order to scale up the production of innovations, it is necessary to put a number of creative people together in an organization and organize the whole innovation process such that their creativity can be used in an optimal way. The advantage of this is that organizations generally have more resources than one individual inventor, and therefore organizations can be used to stimulate or scale up innovations. Examples are public organizations such as universities, like Delft University of Technology. But most of the innovations take place in private firms with a profit objective. Examples are Apple, IBM, Philips. But there are also many smaller and less well-known firms that provide technological solutions for daily problems. Now I will draw attention to the economic determinants of innovation in private, profit-oriented firms. The process of innovation is highly uncertain. Translating a creative idea into something novel and useful can be very costly, while at the same time the benefits are highly uncertain. The uncertain benefits originate from the fact that novel ideas first should prove themselves useful before customers start to buy them. Many studies show that the chance of translating a new original idea into a successful commercial product is less than 0.1%. This means that one in more than 1,000 new ideas becomes a successful commercial product. In other words, whether innovative activity leads to higher profits is highly uncertain. A number of determinants of successful technological innovations can be discussed. We start with external factors. These are factors outside the firm, such as the technical, economic, and legal environment of the firm. And we end with the internal factors. These are factors that are inside the boundaries of the firm. A first important factor is the technical environment in which a firm operates. This is the industrial sector to which the firm belongs. For example, a firm in the aerospace industry operates in a dynamic technological environment in which staying ahead of your competitor is more intense and different than, for instance, in more mature sectors, such as the textile industry. This brings us to a second important external factor, the economic environment as described by competition or market structure. The Austrian-American economist Joseph Schumpeter was one of the first who investigated the impact of market structure on innovation. The central question was, in which kind of markets would firms achieve the highest innovation performance? Two competing explanations exist. First, innovations will mainly be generated in markets with many intensively competing small enterprises that are forced to innovate in order to stay ahead of their competitors. The second explanation claims that markets with less competition will lead to more innovations. The reason is that big firms such as Philips, Unilever, etc., have many resources available such that they can be involved in uncertain innovation processes without immediately going bankrupt after innovation failures. Empirical studies are rather inconclusive. It seems that the technical environment is an important factor. For example, the present-day software industry is dominated by big firms such as Google. The giants in the software industry have many resources available for innovation, but it does not mean they can have a quiet life. They are vigorous competitors in a technologically fast-changing environment. Another example, the oil and gas sector, is also dominated by major players such as Shell. Although firms in this sector do innovate, the competition between them is much less vigorous because the technological environment in which they operate is changing at a slower pace than in the software industry. The last 25 years, technological innovations have become increasingly complex, fast-changing, and much more international than before. The consequence of this development has been that it becomes harder and much more costly for an individual firm to innovate successfully. In order to get sufficient new ideas, firms go beyond their own borders and collaborate with other actors, such as suppliers, customers, and universities, in order to increase their innovation performance. And this is a third determinant of innovation in private firms. This can be a collaboration in a so-called technology cluster, which is a region where firms sharing a common technology, for example, software or biotechnology, engage in buyer, supplier, and complementary relationships for production, but also for collaborative research. The reason is that complex knowledge is often tacit. That means that it is not documented, but it is in the hands and the actions of the engineers or the developers. This requires frequent and close interaction among people. An example is the concentration of semiconductor and software firms in Silicon Valley, but also other examples exist, such as watchmakers in Switzerland or fashion designers in Milan. Software developers of different firms in the Silicon Valley meet each other, have a beer, and exchange views on their tacit knowledge. Being in a technology cluster has a number of advantages. A first advantage is that it can lead to technology spillovers. These are benefits of research and development of an innovating firm that spills over its boundaries and increases the benefits of another innovating firm. A second advantage of being in a technology cluster is that the local labor force is technologically well educated. And another advantage is that suppliers and distributors, as well as other supporting firms such as accountants, lawyers, etc., will be present, which increases the chance of commercial success of the innovations. A fourth external determinant of innovation is the legal environment in which the innovating firm is operating. An innovating person or firm spends a lot of money on developing the idea and transforming it into a concrete application. The high development costs should be earned back after the launch of the product. At that moment, there is a risk that other individuals or firms with the right technological knowledge perform reverse engineering. Reverse engineering means that they investigate novel products or systems, figure out what they consist of, and examine the design as well as how they relate to each other in a technical system. Then they produce and sell their own version of the innovative product or system without having the high development costs the original inventor experienced. If that would occur, the profits and hence the payback opportunities of the original inventor will decline substantially. Intellectual property rights exist in order to avoid this. An example of intellectual property rights are patents, as designed by patent laws. The original inventor gets protection for 20 years, during which his innovation is not allowed to be produced or sold by someone else, unless the original inventor is financially compensated through so-called licenses. Actually, the original inventor receives a temporary monopoly, which guarantees him the possibility of a stream of revenues to earn back his enormous development costs. The incentive of the government to provide legal protection through patents is that a government does not want to discourage original inventor from being innovative in the future. Finally, the fifth determinant has to do with the organization of the innovating firm itself. The American economist William Baumol has emphasized that the power of innovating firms in a capitalist society is caused by the routinization of innovations. In order to routinize innovations, firms that are continuously looking for novel ideas and transforming them into useful products or systems have to work with procedures. However, procedures and creativity are two opposing forces. Creativity is unpredictable, while procedures are developed to make innovation outcomes less unpredictable. That means that a centralized hierarchical organization of the firm with top-down management in which total control is considered key is not the best organization to stimulate the production of innovations. On the other hand, a fully decentralized organization in which everyone is creative and can do what he or she wants is also not going to work. Ambidextrous organizations are often considered as the best of two worlds. It is an organization in which different units can have different organization structures. For example, decentralized units aimed at generating novel ideas coexist with more centralized units that try to translate the creative ideas into concrete products and sell them successfully. Thank you for your attention.